We're back on the farm with Kate Humble and Adam Henson.
What a difference a day makes. The rain has stopped, the sun came out, and everyone's been celebrating.
They certainly have. So join us for an hour of shepherding secrets, leaping lambs, and hard-working sheepdogs. This is Lambing Live. Look, it's looking all snug and cosy in here tonight, isn't it?
It really is.
Steady, steady. That's all right. Now, I need to start by saying an enormous thank you, not just for the thousands, and I mean thousands of emails that you've sent into the programme on lambinglive at bbc.co.uk. We'll be trying to answer some of your questions a little bit later in the programme, but the biggest thank you goes to all of you who took me up on my plea to do a sun dance, because it worked, and it's made us all extremely happy, including the lambs.
It's absolutely wonderful. When that sun came out, the lambs just changed the way they were behaving. They came out into the middles of the fields and were just basking.
They were basking. I mean, it's easy to get a little bit anthropomorphic here, isn't it? But do you think they really do enjoy it, and they really were soaking up that warmth?
They really were. I mean, they just look at them. They're just basking out there. And it's not only more lovely for the lambs, but it's much easier for the shepherds and the Marston family.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, just today has been a complete pleasure. Look at the, I mean, they do look like, I love this one. This one is like, oh, I don't want to get any unsightly white marks. I want to get a good all over tan. But it wasn't sunny until a little bit later in the morning. It was foul in the night, wasn't it?
It really was. Now, Andrew had to go out on his quad bike in early hours in the morning. It was 2 o'clock in the morning, and he had a ewe with a freshly born lamb, and he's using a bit of stealth here. He goes up with the quad bike, blinds the sheep in the headlights, and jumps off and grabs the ewe. She's pretty flighty, this Swaledale, but he's quick on his feet, isn't he?
Now, the reason we hear that he wanted to bring this Swaledale in, well, there was two reasons. One, as you can see, the lamb looked very, very wet and cold, and she's a first-time mum, isn't she? She's what's known as a shearling, so a first-time mum, and he brought her into the barn where we're standing now with her little ram lamb, and he's a very handsome fella, isn't he?
He really is.
Look at him, and I wonder, can I borrow, I know you're very sleepy, but you're very sweet. As you can see, he is very dry and very fluffy and very warm now, and can you guess what his name might be?
Little Spot.
Little Spot. But he's doing very, very well. His mum, she's a little bit shy.
She is. Let me get her
so
out of
she's
the
tucked her way around the corner. But they're doing fine.
There we go. Come on. There we go.
Are you manhandling you?
There we go.
There
she is. Mummy.
There you are. Oh. We'll put you together.
She's a wonderful mother, and I think Andrew has got a lot of hopes for that little lamb.
I think he has, and she is she's a lovely looking Swaledale, actually,
she
isn't
is.
She? Very, very pretty.
Could be a prize winner.
Look, we've been learning, haven't we? And shocking news of the day, Adam Henson got up early and did some work.
I've been out on the farm doing the early rounds with Andrew. So how often are you coming around checking the sheep then, Andrew?
I'm coming around twice a day at the moment. When the weather's really bad, I come around twice a day.
And so what do you do? How do you do it in the morning? What's the plan?
Just ride around and take the feed with us, throw a bit of feed out for them.
A couple of handfuls. Yeah. Nothing else. Are these Beltex lambs a lot softer than the Swales?
I don't think they're softer, but I do think they have less wool on. And so I think the wind and rain doesn't help them. We do seem to lose a few more Beltexes due to the cold weather.
There's a couple down here.
Yeah, if all lambs
they're chunky little lambs, aren't they?
Aren't they?
Nice, bright eyes. I usually hold them up like that and look how full their bellies are. Is that how you do it?
Yeah, no, usually I just have them like that. I do, end the way.
Top like that.
Yeah, but as long as they fall, it doesn't matter which way you hold them,
no,
does it?
No, it doesn't, absolutely.
No.
So let them go. She loves them.
Yeah.
These are a bit littler in here, are they?
Yeah, these are the youngest ones that are outside. So I was a bit concerned about these last night.
Well, yeah. These will be the most vulnerable.
I think they are, yeah.
Yeah, I'll let you do this, you know how much you need.
I don't really, I just guess.
What we've got here is a classic mismothering. We've got a little lamb there that's walked off with the wrong ewe, and she's wandering down to the bottom of the field, and the mother is at the top. And Andrew's got a fantastic eye for it. He's now walking them back up to join the flock. There's one there that's pretty muddy and wet, isn't it? When the wet gets into them and they get cold, I mean, hypothermia sets in pretty quickly, doesn't it?
It does, yeah. That's the problem, isn't it?
This is the key. And they need full bellies.
Yeah.
They've got a good ewe producing plenty of milk, and they've got a full belly.
They stand a lot if the bellies are full.
Well, that was a pretty successful morning, wasn't it?
Yeah, we had a good morning. I was dreading going out this morning, but yeah, things were all right.
Well, it was great for me to be spending some time with a fellow farmer, you know, sharing tips.
That's right.
Now, there's one thing that you tell me that you check indoors and outdoors, and I do it at home, is when you get a lamb up and see them stretch. Why don't you wake him up and just show everybody how it works?
We'll have a go, see if I can get in. Come on, little lamb.
Now, it might look a little bit cruel, but when you wake a lamb up...
A good big stretch.
It has a great big stretch like that. It proves it's healthy and happy, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does, yeah. I don't like to see them sat down, but obviously if they're sat down, they can be asleep or ill. But you get up and do a big stretch, you know they're all right.
And this morning, I mean, you've had some pretty bad mornings last year in the wet, haven't you? But it was okay.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, no, we went around and were very pleased, surprised even, that all the lambs were okay this morning, because it was a terrible night.
And if you do find dead ones, I mean, I suppose it's just part of the job, but still gutting.
It is. You put all that work and effort into, you know, getting your sheep into good order, getting to the right rams, and then and you get them out alive, and everything's hunky-dory, and then you go around and you find a dead one or two. It's soul-destroying, really.
Horrible for all the shepherds over the country if that happens.
Yeah, that's right. It isn't just like us fighting against the weather. It's all the farms in the country. We're just one small family farm, and but there's thousands of others like us.
Now, getting the sheep up onto the fells, the swale dales, something I'm not used to at all, when do you take them up there with their lambs?
Usually take them in May, and we take them up on a nice sunny day if we can, and let them get on with it, really.
And is it a job getting the lambs to follow their mothers up there?
Not really, no, they're used to following the mothers. So the mothers, when they go up, they train the lambs where to go, keep out of dangerous places, and the mothers look after little lambs.
Now, brilliant. Well, lots of people have been asking us how on earth the masters keep track of their sheep once they're up on the fells. Well, here's how.
It's the crack of dawn, and we're checking on the Swaledales after their first cold night back on the hilltops. They appear to have turned up for feeding, but Andrew wants to be sure that none of his flock have gone missing.
Are they all here?
Yeah, I think they're all here, Kate. Oh, that's good. 164, I think we've got, Kate.
164?
Yeah, I think there's 163, or I was the one there, somebody else's. They're getting a different smit mark on.
Now, smit marks are each family has a kind of symbol that they put on their sheep. Is that right? Is that what a smit mark is?
Yeah, that's right. Each farm, each flock has an individual smit mark.
Right. So you can tell at a glance that one's got a particular mark on. I know it belongs to that family. They're not our sheep.
That's right.
Now that one flock has successfully returned to the fell, it's time to get some more ready to send back. But they need fresh smit marking.
Every time they go to the fell or when it wears out, we put some more on. And ours, it's red just on the hind quarters.
And that is unique to you, your sheep.
Yeah, that's right.
Andrew has picked some out for me to do.
Right, I've got to get this right, otherwise someone else will get your sheep. So is it literally just a line?
across there.
It is. We usually go with the put it on the way the wool goes. It goes on neater,
so
easier.
Across
so
like that.
Down there and then down there usually.
Like that.
Yeah.
There you are. You are now proudly a Marston sheep. It's like the Marston football team, isn't it? There we go.
That's it.
Everybody will know that you are Marston sheep and proud of it.
But what if you don't recognise the Smit mark? Well, you can look it up in the Shepherd's Guide, which acts like a telephone directory for sheep and farms throughout the region.
If you lived in the parish of Hilton, for example, and you saw a sheep with an S on it, then you could, if you looked it up in the Shepherd's Guide, you could see that it belonged to a Mr. Jackson of Appleby. You could give him a call.
That's
and he
right.
could get his sheep back.
Yeah.
Is this you?
It is, yep.
Oh, there you are.
Yeah.
Yeah. You've got one on the front as well. Is that, you don't do that one anymore?
We haven't done that one for a while, no. You can change
That's
your marks.
That's how to confuse
slightly.
A stranger.
Yeah, it is.
I'm going to secretly go up and mark them all like this so that I know which ones are which.
Yeah,
the
red mark has stayed the same.
The red stroke over loin. It has indeed, right.
But a good shepherd doesn't need to rely on Smit marks to recognise his own flock. Andrew takes pride on being able to identify individual sheep by their face alone.
If you pick me a sheep out of here, Kate, and said, and then put it back in,
yeah,
to find that sheep, I reckon I could find that sheep. Yeah.
How?
Well, you just know.
Every
you just know
different.
That.
Just like I know you, and you know Rachel,
yeah.
We're different. Sheep are different.
I think you should do that. I think you should do that. Get its tag number. Take it out. Put it back in.
All right. All right. So Andrew has just laid down the gauntlet. He reckons that he can recognise every single one of his sheep, not by the Smit marks, not by the ear tags, but just because they've got different personalities and faces, exactly like people have. I would choose a tricky one.
To check he gets it right, we locate the sheep's ear tag number.
3218, that's the ear tag.
Yep, so you can remember that, 32, 18.
Andrew gets one quick look at the sheep's face.
Right, you're not allowed to watch where she goes.
No.
Does he have a minute to find it?
No, I do not.
Yeah, you're being timed.
Go! Probably are.
The tag number is
3218.
3218.
You
got it. And I have to tell you, you did it in less than a minute. That's pretty impressive. Did you really think that he could do that?
I thought he probably would.
Yeah.
Knowing
Can
Andrew.
You?
Some sheep, most sheep, yeah.
Really?
Not quite as good as Andrew.
It was quite clever. I had no idea he was going to be able to do that.
No, and you picked a really good sheep as well, because it wasn't too distinctive.
Well, that's what I tried to do, make it as tricky as possible. But
yeah,
it did do a good job. Now, you are looking at a star of BBC Radio 1. This morning, Rachel and I were on the Fern Cotton Show because Fern Cotton and her listeners were absolutely determined to try and name a lamb. And as it happened, while we were on the radio, you went into labour and we leapt in to help. Here she is. So you can see it's a Beltex U, blue spot. Viewers, can you remember how many lambs she'd be expecting?
Just the one. Yeah.
And you can
there
see
it is.
It's
getting
a
going.
Beautiful lamb. A big one.
It is a big one. It was very big. Yeah, it was.
There we go. And Mum, straight into bonding.
Yeah,
it's quite a pretty one, isn't it?
It is a very pretty one. I like it.
So yeah, I said to Rachel, what do you think? Could that be the Radio 1 lamb?
Well, it could be.
It could be.
We could call that one. Should we call it Floppy?
Should we call it Floppy? That's what they wanted to call it. So Floppy it is.
Yeah.
And you should meet Floppy. Here she is.
Here she is. Oh, she's asleep. I'll wake her up. Come on, Flappy. Oh, really doesn't want to come and see you.
Enormous. But there you are. So Fern and all the Radio 1 listeners, meet Floppy, your lamb. She's absolutely
gorgeous, isn't she?
She's a real cracker. So there, I hope you're proud of her. That was great.
Yeah.
Absolutely great. And the amazing thing, when you saw Floppy being put in front of her mum there, you instantly saw the mum beginning to lick her and cleaning up. And those first sort of immediate signs of motherhood and bonding are amazing,
yeah,
aren't they,
yeah,
Rachel?
Yeah, you wonder where it comes from, really, because it's just instant. As soon as you put the lamb there, it's licking it straight. Well, usually licking it straight away.
Yeah, have a look at this. We've done a sort of a montage of this for you, just so that you can see. So here you are. And Rachel, presumably, this licking is cleaning off the sort of the birthing stuff and getting them
dry.
It
gets them going. Yeah, it does. It gets the lambs going.
Right, so it's also part of actually keeping them alive.
Yeah, it is. Nothing gets a lamb going better than a sheep, really, putting it in front of the sheep.
And this is the amazing thing, isn't it? So quickly.
Up on its back legs.
Always the back legs?
Yeah, usually the back. They're a lot stronger, you see.
Right,
Yeah.
But it is within moments, and particularly the Swaledales seem to be very quick.
Yeah, they are quick, yeah.
And then, of course, it's the feeding thing. Now, this you'd think would be really quick instinct, but they don't quite get it, do they?
They don't get it straight away.
Look at this one. This is hilarious.
Wait.
Where's it gone? And you look at the mother, she's thinking, what have I given birth to?
Yeah, what is this? Silly animal that I've got.
Absolutely. Yeah. Jesus, lovely. Good. But it must be something that you never tire of, really,
watching
that bond. No, it is. It's
amazing. Yeah, it is. Yeah, definitely.
But there are obviously some sadnesses involved in lambing. It's a sort of, it's a pretty nerve-wracking time, isn't it?
An
emotions swing
you
all
get
over the
up
place.
And down. Yeah, you do. Yeah.
And while we were rehearsing, we were actually in here, Rachel and I were in here yesterday, and we noticed another ewe going into labour. And so we stopped the rehearsal, and Rachel went in. Now you can see you've got that birthing aid there.
Yeah, I put
Rachel.
That on. I could get it on the back of its head, but it was really, really tight in the pelvis bone.
So it's another single lamb with the blue dot there.
It's a really big lamb. Its head was there and its legs were there, but I just couldn't get its legs right up properly you meant to.
Right.
And I couldn't get its head through the bones there. Having a good pull.
You are having a good pull.
Yeah.
And did you feel at that stage that there might be something up, there might be something not quite right?
Yeah. The sheep was small, the lamb was big. It's not a good combination.
Well, Adam was going past the lambing shed and popped in to see if he could lend a hand.
Okay. How
have
you got it
through? Yeah, I nearly, almost
there. Yeah, I got it and it took about here.
Yeah.
On its forehead.
I think we're all right. So we just get a little bit of string onto its legs now. So quite often the lambs are like this and you need to extend their legs into that full diving position.
Yeah.
So we pull the head forward now and it's come through her pelvic corridor.
Right.
And it's yanking its legs back. So we can just get a bit of string on its legs so we've got a better purchase.
Okay.
And then it might come. You wouldn't want to lamb this outside.
No.
I'm still not sure whether I'm going to get this.
Right.
We
so
coming?
Now we've extended the legs.
Yep.
Rachel's just got those, and now she's easing her hand behind the cranium, right behind the back of the lamb's head.
Yep.
Right, here it comes.
Oh my goodness, it's enormous.
Well done.
Well done.
Okay.
Good girl, stay there.
And then down, a downward arc. There we go.
Oh,
right.
Wow. Well done.
No, I don't think it is well done. No, it's dead.
Is it dead?
Is it gone?
Yeah.
You're really gutted with that.
I was absolutely gutted. I was. Yeah.
And even though you know that a certain number of lambs are going to be lost every year.
Yeah, oh, definitely. I mean, you get your losses, which I was really gutting because it was alive as well. And it was just that last final pull that was just too much for it and it just killed it and we just couldn't get it going.
It was a desperately sad moment. I really felt for you after all that struggle and you know, all the work, I suppose, that's gone into getting that ewe healthy and well-fed. And
yeah, you have a lot of expectations when you're rooting around in there. There's a lot of expectation of what might come out of you.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was all sort of gone in a moment, really. So.
It was gone in a moment, but you then had a brainwave, didn't you?
Yeah, we did have a brainwave.
Because, if you remember, yesterday I assisted with the birth of triplets, the Swaledale triplets. Now, the Swaledales, they are very good at looking after two lambs. They've got the two teats,
brilliant.
But three are a bit
they
too
just
many.
Can't do it. No, they can't.
So what did you think we should do?
I thought we should get one of the, I think it was a gimmer that we got off her.
Yeah, and, the female lamb. Yeah,
female lamb, and put it onto the sheep that had lost its lamb.
So what we did was what is called a wet adoption. So you can see Rachel bringing the lamb there, and you're just covering it in.
All the fluid that's just come out of the sheep.
So basically what you're doing is making that lamb appear to be the lamb
that she's
just given birth to.
That's right, yes. So she's never smelt her first, you know, the lamb that we took away from her. And that's her new lamb.
Look at that, instantly
bonding. It is instantly, yeah.
That's just... What a great sight. Interesting. We've had a few questions, Rachel. Now, obviously, that's a Swaledale lamb, Beltex ewe.
Yeah.
And that's not a problem. You can adopt different breeds.
Yeah, you can. It doesn't matter. No, it doesn't matter which. I mean, it's nice to keep the same if you can, but at the time, we didn't have a Beltex that we could have put on it, so we put a mule on, and that's fine. Yeah.
And we can see her here.
Yeah, she's
so, there. So if you remember, I called them Mary, Mungo and Midge, and this is Mary, and doing extremely well with
she
her
is.
New mum.
Yeah, she's doing well. She's
so
she, doing well.
She's actually got a much better chance now because
she
she's got a ewe mum rather than being a pet lamb.
Yeah, no, she'll be a lot better. She'll have a good life.
And
yeah.
presumably the other two.
Yeah, they're doing well as well.
Can we go over and see them?
Look,
I think they're over the other side, aren't they? Oh, there she is.
Oh, chilling now, look at that, chilling. Leave me alone.
Oh, they look fantastic.
Yeah.
So from a tragedy, from a sadness, from losing a lamb, you've actually been able to make something really positive.
Yeah, we have, yeah. It's the best outcome we could have, really.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
It's a fascinating subject, the adoption, and tomorrow we're going to show you another whole different sort of adoption, which is equally fascinating and really, really heartwarming, so that's something to look forward to. Now, on yesterday's show, you met Rachel's lovely daughters, Catherine and Abs, and as you know, we've been filming with the family over the last few months, but we thought that Catherine and Abby should be given a camera to make a film of their own.
Bad idea.
For the last year, the BBC have been coming over to film our farm.
This one look good.
It looks like you got pink hair.
The film does feeding cows.
And our horse Blaze.
Blaze!
Blaze!
We really like feeding the working dogs that live outside in the kennels.
This one's called Smudge. He's a little boy. This one's called Lynn. She's a girl.
This dog's called Coco and she's mine. I think she's about 2 years old. She's not yet been trained, so hopefully we'll have to train her.
They gave us a camera so that we could keep a video diary.
Hi, my name's Catherine and I'm 9 years old.
Hi, I'm Abigail and I'm 6 years old.
Oh. Hi Abigail, how are you doing?
Okay, thanks.
What are these then?
The little puppies.
Oh, how cute. What are they called?
Fizz and the boy we don't have a name for yet.
Do you enjoy stroking them and spending time with them?
What kind of dogs are they?
Border collies. And they're just adorable.
We do jobs on the farm to help Mum and Dad out.
Dad's asked me to do the sheep pens.
What are you doing in the sheep pens?
Mucking them out because it's all messy.
Rather be sat inside watching telly, Abigail.
No.
Would you not? You've got a big pile of poo.
Yeah.
It's really nice to have lots of space to play in.
How are you doing, lassie? Ah, you should be a funny lass. Hi. She's a bunny lass. What do you think about her? Da 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 da.
Abby, you're obviously tastier than me. That lamb's eating your welly. That was a brilliant film. Did you have fun making it?
Yeah.
Was it good?
Yeah.
Now, where's Catherine tonight?
Well, I think she's twisted her neck and she's really hurt her neck.
Oh, poor Catherine. Shall we give her a wave and see if she's all right? Hello, Catherine. Get better soon. Now, how are you feeling? Are you feeling brainy this evening?
All right.
A little bit brainy. Yeah. Shall I say, I've got some questions for you. One came in from Ella Boot, she's seven, and she wants to know what it feels like when you put your hand inside a sheep to help it bring out a lamb. Have you ever done that before?
Yeah.
You have? And what does it feel like?
It feels really warm.
Yeah. Is it a bit slushy?
Yeah.
Is it? A bit gooey?
Yeah.
And what are you feeling for?
A lamb.
You're feeling for a lamb?
Yeah.
And what's the bit of the lamb that you want to feel first?
Its legs.
Right. Front legs or back legs?
Front.
Yeah. And then what do you want
and
to feel?
And then its head.
Yeah.
And then its body, and then its two legs.
And then its two legs at the back.
Yep.
And that's the perfect lambing lamb then, isn't it? Now, the next question. We're being taken over by lambs. I'm totally upstaged by a beautiful girl in a sparkly headband and some lambs. Now, Samuel Mundell, I think he's just emailed in while we've been on air. He wants to know two things. What's the best thing about living on a farm? Is it having lambs?
Everything.
Everything. I'd agree with you there. So there's no worse things then?
No.
There you are, Samuel. There's nothing bad about living on the farm. I think we've got time for just one more question. Just one more question. Very quickly. Oh, Joan Bell wants to know, when you're bottle feeding lambs in a pen, how do you know, and there's lots of them like there are now, how do you know which ones have eaten? Do you know the answer?
Like the full, like if you carry them, like if you lift them up, you can tell if they're full or not full.
Okay, so they've got big fat tummies like this one here.
Yeah.
And also they tend to get a bit sleepy, don't they, when they've had lots of food. Abby, you've been absolutely fantastic. Thank you very much. I'm not going to know what's happening in this programme anymore because the lamb is eating my cards. But you're not the only ones that have been playing on the farm, have you? The lambs have been loving the sunshine, and as soon as the sunshine came out, the lambs went mad and caused mayhem.
For most of the day, young lambs like to stick close to their mums. But pretty soon, they must learn to fend for themselves, and they do this through play. The best time to see this is in the magical hour before sunset, when they start to build up their courage and learn the skills they're going to need to survive.
Now that these lambs are a couple of weeks old, they're becoming much more independent and leaving their mother and getting braver and charging off by themselves like a bunch of unruly teenagers. It's great coming down to the field in an evening and watching the lambs getting into these lamb gangs and playing. What these lambs are doing now is learning their strengths, learning how to run as a flock. Testing their ability and their muscles, playing with each other and jumping in the air, skipping. It's as if the lambs are using up all their excess energy before bedtime. But they're jumping, some of them, all 4 feet off the ground. In fact, they're so excited by life that they're producing serotonin, the happiness chemical. They really are showing all the signs of what we would assume is happiness and play. And they're literally jumping for joy. really having a good time. You know, they look like they're just full of the joy of spring.
These lambs seem to be full of energy. I guess if they're going to survive on the Cumbrian hills, they're going to need to learn to be agile and sure-footed.
They'll tend to run around for, you know, half an hour together, and then it's like magic. It all comes to an end, and they suddenly realise, where's my mum? Oh my word, I'm lost.
It's a bit like when you were a kid and your mum's calling you in for tea. Come on, where have you been? I'm over here. And now that little lamb will stick close to its mum for the night. She's not only the milk bar, but also provides protection and reassurance. It can play with its mates again tomorrow.
Those playing lambs are so lovely, aren't they?
They're lovely. Yeah, I love seeing them do that. It's great.
Do you have time to go down and sit on the edge of a field and watch that?
Not really. Maybe after lambing, when they're a bit older. Yeah.
Now, we've got all the sheepdogs here. This is where they live. Yep. Tell me who we got.
This is Bowie, who's a son of Lynn, right up at the top. And then this is Hope. And then this one here is Smudge. So.
And important tools on the farm.
Yeah, very. You can't manage without them on a sheep farm, no.
Now, lots of people have been writing in saying the dogs really are the stars of the show, but it takes an awful lot of dedication and hard work to train one. Have a look at this.
The sheepdog really is the shepherd's best friend, vital for working and moving sheep right across the Cumbrian fells. The Marstons have two full-time working sheepdogs on the farm. Donald has trained up his dog Hope by himself.
Oh, away. I called it Hope in the hope that it would make a good one.
Andrew's dog is a border collie called Lynn.
Lynn, come by. Come by.
And Lynn recently had two puppies, a bitch and a dog.
Come on, Lynn.
Come on.
Hey, puppies.
I'd be far too soft and you'd end up on the sofa in 2 seconds flat, wouldn't you? And that would do you no good at all.
So how old will they need to be before you can start training them?
Probably about 6 months. We'd take them out among the sheep.
Yeah.
Probably by about a year. You know, they should really be showing a good interest.
So you're going to have your work cut out?
We are, because Smudge, that we're going to try and train, is quite headstrong.
Right.
And he's quite rough with the sheep as well.
So you've got some other youngsters, have you?
Yeah, there's one. He's actually 2 years old. We've had him out a few times, but he's been a little bit rough with the sheep.
Right.
Which isn't a good thing, but he's very, very keen. So we'll maybe try and take him out and get him going if we can.
You can hear him barking. Take me out now! Take me out now! So how long have you been working with him now?
Oh, I've only had him out a couple of times.
Right.
So he's just like a really daft pup when he gets out among the sheep.
Yeah.
So he needs a lot of work doing with him. Come on then.
Rachel grew up working and training champion sheepdogs with her father, Harry Hutchinson. But even she may have her work cut out with young Smudge.
So he's got his tail up there.
Yeah.
My dad always said that's a really bad sign in a dog because it thinks it's in charge.
Right.
So by the time we come back down here later, he'll have its tail down hooked.
Right. Is instinct anything to do with it, or is it all training?
Definitely instinct, yeah.
Yeah.
But you do have to spend a lot of time. Some of you spend a lot more time than others.
Yeah.
Like he's very headstrong, he doesn't listen very well.
Right.
So I'll have to spend a lot of time with him to make him into a good dog.
We've set aside some sheep to work with that are fit and well and not in lamb. Once we've let Smudge get a good look at the sheep, it's time to let him off the leash.
Hello. Let him have a little play. So he's just going a bit silly. Right. Sit down, sit down. Hey! Sit down, sit.
So what he's doing now is entirely natural to him.
Yeah.
All that movement, all that knowing that he's got to herd them,
yeah,
it's just a natural instinct.
Yeah.
It looks as though Smudge is displaying some promising herding behaviour. This harks back to the dog's predatory instincts because all dogs evolved from wolves.
But I think it's amazing just seeing a completely raw dog like this have the instincts to go in and move sheep around. And he may not be doing it in a very ordered manner, but even so, he could so easily have gone in and attacked them.
Training a sheepdog takes a lot of skill, and you need to be a disciplined taskmaster.
Away then.
Come back. When you give him the away command, are you trying to get him to go past the sheep?
Yeah. Away. Sit down. Sit down. Sit down. Sit down. If you just go around them, Kate, and I'll see if I can round the sheep.
Yeah.
See if we can get him in the middle of the field.
You can give me the away command if
away.
You like.
Sit down!
The sheep seem a bit confused.
Come on, you lot. Go and be sheep.
Yeah, just in your own time, Kate. You're all right.
Go on with you.
I wait. He's doing good, actually, because he would have been biting them.
Yeah.
Good dog. Sit down. Sit down. Good boy.
God, that was fantastic
that was
for him
good.
To leave a sheep.
Yeah, and come back.
That looked like a dog that knew what it was doing.
Yeah, he did all right. It's better than he did the previous two times I've had him out.
So, I mean, how long do you think it will be before he could be working?
Maybe 6 weeks till lambing time. I could maybe gather a field in with
really?
Him.
Really?
Yeah. I think he's got potential. It's just honing that. Give him time.
Yeah.
He'll get there.
But does Smudge know who's in charge? Is his telltale tail up or down?
Oh, there's a little bit left. Not too bad to what it was.
Not too bad. Not too bad, but he's
keep
still
it
showing
down,
spirit.
Keep it down.
Well, well, Donald, what do you reckon? Are they ever going to be able to train that dog?
It's determined, but Rachel's determined, and I think Rachel might win eventually.
Little Smudge. He's like a wolf, isn't he?
Yeah, he's a tough character. If you can train him, he'll make a good dog, because he's powerful, isn't he?
It is, yeah.
But he'll take a bit of bossing. But if anybody can, Rachel will.
Now, who have you got here?
Hope. This is Hope. This is Hope. I had a dog run over several years ago on the road, and to buy a dog that's trained, it cost £2,000 or £3,000. So I went to Rachel's dad. I said, have you got any pups on? And he said, yes, I've got a six-week-old. Well, I've got a litter of pups. Take your pick. And I called it Hope, hoping it would make a good one. and it has. A lot of farmers tend to maybe neglect the young dogs. They're in a hurry. We'll take the old dog that can do the job. Well, I didn't have an old dog, so this had to go with me from 6 weeks old. And so right from an early age, you got every chance. And I'm pleased with it. Yeah.
And they're a really important part of the working tools on the farm, aren't they?
Yes. I know I remember once wrote an essay at a school, and I finished the last paragraph, said, the tractor replaced the horse, but there isn't a machine that'll ever replace a dog. Yeah. And I wrote that 40 years ago, and it's just as true. You
absolutely.
Know, you can't replace dogs.
And this is a classic border collie, although a tricolour.
Yeah, different. I mean, you get black and white, you get black, you get all colours, but this is tricolour, and he's a lovely natured dog. He doesn't like cameras, but he's a lovely natured. Yeah.
And will only work for you?
Yeah, it'll only work for me, and Andrew's got a dog, and it's just as good, probably better than this one, and it'll only work for him. Yeah, as soon as you let this one out, if somebody else lets it out, it'll run about the yard to find me.
Right.
And if I let Andrew's dog out, it'll run about the yard to find him.
Now, dogs are an important tool, but there's one tool I've seen you using. You're pretty nifty with it. Let's take a look at this. The master of crookwork.
Ah, right. Yes. Well.
So, look,
well,
there's Andrew having a go with it. You've obviously taught him well.
Well, he's taught himself, yes. I mean, yeah, this is my work. This is my work stick.
Now here he is. Look, there. You've got that. He's got that. You're using catching it round the neck.
Yep.
Which is quite handy.
Yep.
Look, he's quite nifty on his feet, isn't he?
Yeah, that's my dog. Now I went to catch some this morning. Now I was checking that sheep, and there's that one. But yes, from about 3 hours old, the lamb decides it doesn't want human beings, and so it'll run away. And so it's much, you know, you try to grab it like that, and it's gone. Whereas if you've got a stick like I'm showing you on there, like this one.
It's an extension of the arm, isn't it?
Well, exactly, it is. I mean, if I've got my dog and my stick, and I was looking today for the stick because I knew I was going shepherding, and if I'm going to catch a lamb, I'm pretty useless at running. And so, but if I've got that, and I can get the sheep or the lamb at the back of a wall, and they think there's a gap between, then I can stick that out. And so, I mean, people think a stick is for farmers to lean on, that we spend our lives leaning on sticks, you know, that's our occupation. But I usually have my stick wrong end up, and I'm going about like that. And as I say, if there's a sheep, you know, going in the back of that wall, I just hook it.
Now, this one here, Donald.
Yes.
Now, that's a bit of a fancy one, isn't it?
It has a very sheltered life. It lives under the stairs. It comes out on very special occasions, as in Kirby Stephen Tupsales. And so it that's made of a Swaledale tup horn, as you can see. It's got a...
And it's got a beautifully engraved and painted Swaledale there. I don't know if you can see that. Lovely.
On there, yes. And so, as I say, it's very beautiful, but apart from special occasions, it's not used much, you know. But this one, although it's ugly, it's very
pretty handy.
It's very handy, and I can catch my sheep with that one. And so, dog and stick together, we can go places.
Brilliant, thank you, Donald. Now, there's the sheep on the wall's back. At one time, it was worth a fortune and funded lots of things in this country, but now it's pretty worthless. And I went on a journey to find out more.
If I'd been a farmer in the 13th century, I'd have been a very rich man. 700 years ago, British wool was worth up to 30 times more than it is today. It was so prized that Italian merchants were prepared to pay for it 20 years in advance.
This beautiful, long, lustrous fleece at one time was hugely important to Britain. Wool was one of our major exports, and the wool merchants made an absolute fortune from wool.
To see how this extraordinary wealth shaped our country, I'm leaving my farm in the Cotswolds for London. I've come to see a woolen gem which lies at the seat of the nation's power. It's no place for wellies. I remember my dad telling me as a boy about something called the woolsack. I never thought I'd get a chance to see it, but today I'm meeting Mark Collins, resident historian at the House of Lords, who's given me special access to this woolen treasure.
Mark. Adam.
My word, what a room.
Yes, it's the most magnificent of the rooms in the Palace of Westminster, the House of Lords chamber.
Certainly impressive. Goodness me. And is this the woolsack?
Yes, that's right. There are three altogether. So the Lord Chancellor used to sit here and preside over the House. Now we have the Lord Speaker. And for 700 years, they've been a symbol of the wealth and power of the country as it was in the medieval period.
It's quite firm, isn't it?
Yes, it is. It's actually not completely filled with wool today. It has a wooden frame and then webbing and a padded seat filled with wool from the United Kingdom and also 15 Commonwealth countries.
Amazing. Am I allowed to sit in it?
Yes, please do.
What a treat. Oh, it's really quite comfortable. Silence. Order! Order! Oh yes, I think I could settle into this quite nicely.
This place speaks of authority and empire. And between the 13th and 18th centuries, wool provided the foundations of our growing ambitions as a world power. Kings and queens quickly realised wool's potential as a source of income. The Hundred Years' War against the French received much of its funding from a hated and heavy wool tax. No king was more indebted to wool's wealth than Richard the Lionheart. Seized on his return from the Crusades, his captors demanded a huge ransom. A ransom which included 50,000 sacks of finest English wool. But the powers of the realm didn't have it all their own way. I'm on my way to Romney Marsh on the Kent coast to discover wool's criminal record. Richard Platt knows everything there is to know about smuggling.
He's even written books on it.
Hello, Adam.
Hi, great to see you.
And you.
What a lovely spot, isn't it?
Isn't it beautiful?
Richard's taken me to the heart of smuggling country, around Fairfield Church. The Romney sheep have grazed these fields for centuries.
Now, you don't really imagine the smuggling of wool, do you?
Well, no, I guess you don't. I think that we associate smuggling with things like brandy and tobacco and lace and so on and so forth. But 500 years ago, wool was a very, very valuable commodity, and it was a mainstay of the British economy. And it was also taxed. It was taxed quite highly. And taxation is what spawned smuggling. So the people producing wool here had an incentive to move it to the continent to sell and avoid taxation.
So why were the Romney Marshes here a haven for smuggling?
Partly because they were so remote. We've seen all these dikes and ditches full of water, and that made the whole area a maze, and it prevented the customs authorities from pursuing the smugglers, who of course knew it like the backs of their hands. And of course the other factor that made smuggling so prevalent here was the Romney Marsh sheep themselves. And there were hundreds of thousands of them. I mean, far, far more than we see here today.
Well, let me see if I can grab one. We'll have a closer look. So if you go to that wing there.
So this is a pure Romney. I mean, these have virtually remained unchanged, haven't they? And the Romney was the breed that survived in these marshes, a wonderful, what they call a dual-purpose breed, really. It could convert forage and produce good meat, but also this wonderful wool. Really long, fantastic. Isn't it, Richard?
Fantastic, really long fibres. These long fibres made the Romney wool really valuable and really easy to spin, and it made very, very fine cloth.
Fantastic sheep. Here they are, still today. Just wish the wool was worth as much.
Another reason Romney Marsh was so favoured by smugglers was its proximity to beaches like this one at Littlestone. On a clear day, you can see France, little more than 20 miles across the water.
OK, Adam, so this is where it all happened, really. This is where the contraband wool left Britain and headed for the continent.
It's amazing to think, isn't it? The wool smugglers down here at night, boats on the sand, loading up the wool, heading off to France.
That's right. Wool smugglers specifically have been nicknamed owlers, partly because of their nocturnal habits, but also some people say because they used to use a twit-twoo as a way of communicating to each other.
And how was it clamped down on? I mean, presumably the kings of England didn't like it happening.
Well, no, they didn't. There was a guard of what were called riding officers, who were mounted customs men, really, who worked on land rather than from sea. But there were very, very few of them. There were only 8 in Kent.
So you can imagine. A lot of land to cover.
They had a huge amount of territory to cover, and you can imagine that the chances of you being caught for smuggling are pretty slim when there's only that much resistance to what you're doing.
And if you did get caught, was it a severe fine?
Theoretically, you faced the death penalty for smuggling. But, of course, you had to be caught and you had to be convicted before you could be hanged. And you could avoid being caught if you could bribe the customs man. And juries often wouldn't convict because they knew these guys.
They were all in on it,
yes.
Great business to be in.
Yeah, it was a great business to be in if you could get away with it.
The arrival of cotton from the New World marked the beginning of the end for English wool. As foreign demand waned, so too did profit margins for the smugglers. By 1800, 500 years of wool smuggling had all but ended, as too had the heyday of British wool.
I always knew that wool was once a major part of the British economy, and an important export commodity, and the wealth made from wool helped shape the British landscape. But what I hadn't realised is that wool taxes fuelled wars, and those same taxes drove people down here in the southeast to create a wool smuggling industry with stakes so high that they were prepared to risk their lives for it.
My amazing story, that, isn't
it? It is incredible.
And it is absolutely criminal that wool isn't worth more.
Well, we're getting there. Give us a couple of years and I reckon it'll be right back up on its feet. So watch that space.
There you are. Invest in wool. Now, it's question and answer session, and you can send in your questions by contacting lambinglive@bbc.co.uk, or you can do what this clever lad did, which was see Christine in town and give her a question. This is Ben Alderson, who's 13 years old, and he's from Appleby, and he wants to know, how much does it cost to scan a sheep?
Well, I pay about 50p.
I know the Mastons pay about 50p as well, and it's worth every penny, isn't it?
It is, and the scanners can make good money from it, because they're doing about, what, 100 an hour?
Yep.
But I know it's hard work, but
it is extremely hard work. I have to say, it was a freezing day when we did it, and Paul was absolutely non-stop while he
was
scanning.
Quite a skill, though.
Very, very great skill. Jay Hall wants to know, how old does a ewe have to be before she can have her first lamb? Good question, Josie.
Well, lambs can have lambs. So when these little lambs that were born this spring, you could put them to the ram in the autumn if they're heavy enough and they're big enough. So some farmers will wait till the lambs are sort of 45, 50 kilos, and they might put them back to the ram to lamb after their at their first birthday. But generally, as a rule of thumb, and certainly up here in the uplands, you'd wait for them to lamb on their second birthday.
Okay, so it does depend slightly on the breed of sheep and where you are.
Yeah.
Okay, let's see what else we've got in here. Oh, here's one from Katerina Nicola, and she would like to know why you don't towel dry lambs when they're born. She's seen that the mothers groom them, but she's also seen that they could get really cold, that they do get really cold. Maybe they could even get pneumonia.
Well, that is true, but the mothers do an amazing job at licking the lambs dry. And that stimulus from the mother's tongue licking the newborn lamb is like magic to get the lamb up on its feet and encourage it.
Well, that's exactly what Rachel was saying earlier. She said it's like a kind of kickstart almost for the lamb.
Now, if you can find a wet lamb out in the field sometimes and it's soaking wet and freezing cold, and then you can rub it dry and put it in the warm box and warm it up. But generally, I think it's best just to let the mother carry on.
Well, there you are. There you are, Katerina. That's why we don't run around with towels all day. Now, how much would you like to have gone to this school? This is a shout out for the geography team at Waldgate College in York, who have been told that their year 8 geographers, their homework, guess what it is?
Watching Lambing Live.
It is. I hope you're watching. And then you'll get full marks or whatever it is. And finally, Ralph Ellis would like to ask you, how does a mummy sheep know her lambs from all the others?
All by smell. That licking process.
No.
Oh.
Code.
Oh, there we go. Now, it's non-stop for the Marstons, even at New Year.
It's January, and the mild weather means I can take to the hills. Our sheep stay outside all year round, unless they're really poorly. However, our cattle are kept in barns throughout winter to keep them out of the mud, and they rely on feed and a bed of straw. The new year brought with it fresh life on the farm.
Now, this calf was born on the 1st of January 2011. It's mother's pure Limousin cow, but the calf's got by a Belgian Blue Bull.
Like all good mothers, she's protective of her calf.
That's the first calf of 2011. There's a nice boxy head, got bright eyes, but she's not to be trusted. And I think I probably better shut the door now, or else we might have an escaped cow.
Scanning has confirmed that the rams have done their job, and now they're being rewarded with a well-earned rest.
You want to shout?
How good!
That's it, spawn, tremendous. Put it right along the trough, Abigail. Yeah, these are the tups we've just taken away from the ewes now. After scanning, take all the tups away. They've all done their job and earned their keep. These have a bit of a life of leisure now, really. We feed them through the winter, and then they have all summer to feed themselves back up to be in peak condition for next October. The Beltexes have done their job very well. The swale there, he's a hard old tup, and he's done a really good job again for us this time. He came out of retirement. We haven't used him for a few years, but one or two of the other tups didn't work as well as they might, so he got a reprieve.
He's a very old chap. He had an operation that to remove his eye. He had a growth behind his eye. You know, we look after him the very best we can. He's done a really good job. He owes us nothing. His progeny are far outweighed what we paid for that tup. So he's, a bit like a family member, really. So we'll, he'll be here for the rest of his days. Whether he works or not, that's irrelevant. He's here to stay.
What's his name?
Sleddle Hall Dejember.
Weird.
Weird.
Over in the barns, some of the cattle are in for a treat. We've brought in a specialist, Steve Parr, to give a few of our show cattle a designer haircut. We think they're better than the average cow, and we want to show them off.
Obviously the first time they're very nervous because of the noise, but if I did him again in another month, they'd hardly move. They enjoy it, really. Odd ones don't, but the majority just enjoy it. They'll just stand there and just enjoy it.
It's quite an art.
We want the hair to stand high up on the edge, but not above the top, by which, from behind, it makes it look wider. So obviously we don't want to cut it round. We just want it to come to like a point on an edge, which gives it more of a table look from behind. And obviously all the expensive parts here and down the back. So the more we got here, the better it looks.
We're getting ready for the Kirby Classic, our first show of the year.
They should do well, hopefully. It's just a matter of trying to bring out the best what they've got. If they've got bad points, trying to hide it and to expand the good points. It's no different at the end of the day than somebody brushing their dog and having it tucking to have its hair cut, or showing a horse and trimming that as well, really, is it?
Meanwhile, I'm helping Andrew and Donald to separate out the yows that are fit enough to return to the fell.
If we can feel the backbone fairly well, it means that they're not maybe as fit as they might be. If we can't feel the backbone and there's a nice cover of flesh, that means they're in nice order. These here are the twins and the single ones. So these are the ones that are going back to the fell.
With the weather calm for once, Donald takes the opportunity to shepherd the selected yows 5 miles up the fell.
You can't rush sheep that's in lamb, so I think that's my afternoon's work, just quietly taking these up onto the fell. And hopefully they'll stay there for a month, if the weather's kind. That'll do.
Leaving the sheep to roam the common land up here will give our farm meadows a chance to recover before lambing time.
I feel like we're about to do a two running sketch.
It's blowing a gale.
It is blowing a gale. Well, it's almost the end of the show, but if you want to email in any more questions for Abby, are you ready for them, aren't you, Ab?
Yeah.
Then it's lambinglive@bbc.co.uk. And coming up tomorrow, I have a go at the ancient art of stonewalling.
I'm not sure I am, actually. And it's Abby and Catherine's second film in the snow.
It is. It was a fantastic, it looks great fun. And then you will be meeting this little lad. This is the latest addition to the Marston family. He was born today and we'll introduce you to him tomorrow. But we will be back at 8 o'clock, Abs. So in the meantime, everybody say goodbye. Olivia, look at the camera. Bye. See you tomorrow. Bye.